Good evening, and if you'd please stand to join me in the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the October 24th, 2016 Selectmen's Meeting. Chairman Bridle is not here this evening, so I'll be sitting in as chairman. And let's get started. First on our agenda is public comment period. Is there anybody here from the public? Charlie?
I'll make it very quick. I just wanted to touch briefly that on appointment number two, Jason, the town planner, is talking about ADU, proposed zoning. For those at home, it's an accessory dwelling unit. I think this is a very exciting thing. I think what it is for people at home is, as of June 1st, 2017, the new state law will limit municipalities' ability to enact zoning that prohibits or restricts accessory dwelling units or accessory apartments. I think what makes this exciting is, you know, they enacted the law due to its express findings that there's a growing need for more diverse, affordable housing opportunity in New Hampshire, and that accessory dwelling units provide important benefits by offering housing opportunities to millennials, college graduates, saddled with significant student loan debt, as well as the elderly and disabled residents. I'm just going to skip down to another paragraph that I think, you know, touches on that I think is important. There's a family component to this where, you know, people don't have to worry about all kinds of apartments popping up everywhere, because additionally, apartments can limit the number of accessory apartments per lot to no more than one and require that a homeowner demonstrate that the primary dwelling or the accessory apartment is the homeowner's primary place of residence. Although the municipality cannot specify which unit the homeowner must occupy, municipalities may enact provisions to ensure that the necessary unit has adequate parking and can establish standards for maintaining the aesthetic continuity with the principal dwelling. Municipalities can also act minimum and maximum sizes for accessory dwelling units, provided that the municipalities cannot restrict the accessory dwelling unit size to less than 750 square feet. And I think that's important because there's a family component to this. So, you know, we're going to have somebody that, you know, has some skin in the game living in the premises. It's just not going to be the Wild West. I think this is a great thing, and it's exciting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'd ask that the board, through the planner, could let people know. I stopped to see Jason today and let everybody know on the planning board is having public hearings. So if anybody wants to come in and weigh in, it'd be a great thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public wishing to speak? Seeing none, we'll go to announcements and community calendar. Regina?
I don't have anything, Mr. Chairman.
Rick?
No, thank you very much.
And I have nothing.
One thing that we could ask, Fred, when is going to be the leaf pickup this year? Do you know the exact date?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I do. And the Public Works Director is here to correct me. It's October 31st. It begins and it'll end November 4th.
Okay. So we'll find out from him. We'll talk about it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's always eagerly awaited.
Yes.
All right, the consent agenda. Release of welfare lien tax map 146, lot 033.
I motion to move the consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. Passes. Appointments. Ed Tinkner, Chief Assessor.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Here this evening to present the second half tax warrant for 2016, and that is in the amount of $25,877,726. Also want to let you know that the value as a result of the 2016 townwide revaluation is the result. This is the result of that. I also wanted to let you and the people at home know that the 2016 tax rates have been set, of course, And the town rate this year is $16.08 compared to last year's $19.16, or a reduction of 16.1% as a result of the revaluation.
That's the total tax rate, right?
The town portion, yes, 1608. The precinct is 1682, and the partial would be $16.15.
But the town includes the school and
the utility school, yeah.
Yeah, the 1608. Yep. Just so people realize that, sure. That it's not just the right.
Right. Yep.
Okay.
What do you mean? It's the for the town is 1608, and then yep. How much extra is it for the precinct?
An additional 74 cents for the precinct.
Okay, so it's add that 74
correct.
Onto the
08. That would give you okay. The 1682. Right.
Thank you.
So I'm looking for any questions I can answer, or a motion to approve the second half tax warrant.
Any questions, Regina?
Yeah, just to clarify, so it's dropped considerably from last year, over 16%.
Yes.
Okay. Yep. Yeah, looks great.
Okay.
Thank
and
you.
What do you on a $300,000 home? How does that change from this last year to this year?
Christy probably has better numbers. I believe it should be pretty close to level, but it's upstairs.
Phil here with his
adding. It'd be simple to say.
19, what was it last year? 18.
It'd be $5,700 on a $300,000 house using $19 approximately. 16, of course, a $300,000 house at 16 would be $4,800. But because of the reval, that $300,000 house last year potentially would be 350, 360, or somewhere.
I understand that. So
it's pretty
basically, on a $300,000 last year, it would have been $5,700.
Yes.
And guessing, it's $4,800.
Right, for a $300,000 house.
Yeah. Those are round numbers. Okay,
yep.
I just
yep.
like to keep them round
sure.
when I'm talking to everybody. It's easier.
All right. No questions? No more questions?
Thank you.
We need a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Jason Bichon, town planner, to speak about the ADU.
Good evening.
Good evening. Welcome.
Thanks. And they have Mark Gerald joining me.
It's a twofer.
Jason, just one at a time. Can you just explain what ADU is?
Certainly.
So the public realizes.
Yes. An ADU is an accessory dwelling unit, and I was going to recap a little bit anyway. Senate Bill 146 regarding accessory dwelling units, it was signed into law by the governor on March 16th of this year. That law takes effect, as Mr. Preston noted in the beginning, on June 1st, 2017. That would be RSA 674:71 when it takes effect. Mark and I have been working with the planning board on updating our zoning ordinance to establish ADU regulations. The issue is, if the regulations are not in place by June 1st of 2017, then anyone could come in and establish an ADU anywhere in the town just by building permit. That's a concern because, you know, it could have a definite negative impact on neighborhoods and the community as a whole. We need regulations to actually, you know, oversee the establishment of these units. As Mr. Preston had noted, I mean, it's not necessarily a bad thing everywhere, but there's certain neighborhoods that could be significantly impacted by these units, and that's why it's important to establish these regulations. I know in an email you received some information regarding the accessory dwelling units. I was going to walk through the accessory dwelling unit sheet provided by New Hampshire Housing, just to give an overview of everything that it involves. With regard to the accessory dwelling unit, it must be an independent living unit, meaning it has its own sleeping, cooking, eating, and sanitation facilities incorporated. It must have an interior door between it and the principal dwelling unit. That's for attached accessory dwelling units. There are attached and detached, and we'll get into that a bit afterward. And also must have adequate water supply and sewage disposal. A municipality, there's things that a municipality may or may not do according to the state law in establishing its own ADU ordinance. A municipality may control the appearance to maintain the look and feel of any single family home, such as architecture, driveways, and off-street parking. By the look and feel, you can make sure that there's no like visible staircases from the roadway and so forth, so that that home still looks like a single family home. Whether it has two units or one, you shouldn't be able to distinguish it from one that's just a single family without an ADU in it. We may require owner occupancy of one of the units, but we can't say which one. The owner of the home can occupy the accessory dwelling unit or the principal dwelling unit if they choose, but we can require them to occupy one of those. We may require demonstration that the unit is the owner's primary dwelling unit. So, it can't be like a vacation home for them. It has to be their primary dwelling unit. We can require that. We can regulate the number of occupants per bedroom, consistent with HUD laws. Continue to limit the number of unrelated individuals within a single unit. It allows for that. It allows to establish minimum and maximum ADU sizes. But that gets into something with the must-nots as well. With regard to that, we can't require it to be smaller than 750 square feet. The owner may make it smaller, and this is a discussion we've had for months with this that's been a very complicated thing in communicating with others on this matter. But we can't require it to be smaller than 750, but the owner, the way it's written, can make it smaller on their own accord. A municipality must not require familial relationship between the occupants of the principal dwelling unit and the ADU. So it's not, typically you think of in-law apartments as a family member, an elderly family member, a college student, somebody finishing up college, wanting to occupy that unit. We can't require that here. They can rent it to anybody they choose, according to the state law. We can't require it to only have one bedroom, so two-bedroom unit would be consistent with that. We can't require additional lot area or additional dimensional standards, but we can require that if we allow detached for those units. We can't require separate water and septic systems for the principal unit and the ADU. And we can't require that interior door that I spoke of earlier between an attached ADU and the principal unit and the ADU for attached units to remain unlocked. You can't require that as well. What I'd like to do now, we also received, actually, in your information, you have some information from the Rockingham Planning Commission, which we utilized in drafting our amendment to this date, and some good information in there. They highlight some of the concerns that we have about short-term rentals and condominium conversion, for example. What I'd like to do, and I believe you also have this, is a copy of our latest ordinance that's been updated consistent with the last meeting that the planning board had last Wednesday evening. I'd just like to walk you through that quickly just to give you an overview of the ordinance and how it's structured. And then after that, I'll take any questions anybody has. We have a definition set. In the definition section, we added a definition of accessory dwelling unit. That definition is consistent with the state law, what's allowed under state law. We did add some language regarding detached accessory dwelling units because that is something that the planning board is looking at permitting here. So we added some language to that effect as well, along with the state's model for definition. We did add a new section, or Article 3A, for accessory dwelling units under our use regulations. The use regulation on this 3.1 itself adds the reference to the accessory dwelling unit as well. And then Article 3A would be part of that, a subsection of Article 3. And I'll just go through these one by one. 3-A1, location and quantity, does talk about allowing only one accessory dwelling unit per lot. Permits, the planning board has expressed interest in doing this through a conditional use permit from the planning board, which we believe is a good oversight, good mechanism to handle this type of use. 3-A3 talks about provisions for living facilities. We talk about the sleeping, eating, cooking, and sanitation. The board did want to be more specific on cooking and sanitation, so we highlighted stove, refrigerator, and sink for cooking, and shower, toilet, and sink for sanitation. So we have the reference to what a kitchen would typically have and what a bathroom would typically have. We also talk about the bedrooms, no bedroom being less than 7 by 10, and in no any case, no larger than 200 square feet in size. The next section, 3-A4, talks about occupancy requirements. Initially, we had looked at laying out a bunch of different entities like LLCs and partnerships and corporations and so forth. The board opted, through some comments that we received subsequent, to a more condensed approach. So we basically model the state law by just saying owner occupancy of either the single-family dwelling unit or the accessory dwelling unit shall be required, and that the owner shall demonstrate to the satisfaction of the planning board that one of the units is his or her principal place of residence. They wanted a more consolidated format to that. We talk about no more than two persons occupying a bedroom. We talk about no more than 6 months at a time, or no less than 6 months at a time that it can be rented out for. That's so that we don't get, you know, with the seasonal rental sort of thing. The whole intent of this law is for permanent housing, permanent rental housing, so that assures that. We talk about the certificate of rental occupancy being current. We talk about no home occupations or businesses being allowed. Site location and size. Here's where we talk about the detached units. We're talking about a detached unit only being permitted where within a structure that predates the enactment of this article, and it's already detached from the principal dwelling unit. So someone can't come along later and build a structure and say, I'm doing this site, and then I'm going to put an accessory dwelling unit, a detached one, in later. And we use the existing foundation as establishing the footprint that meets that criteria, and that was talked about with the planning board last week. An accessory dwelling unit, the number that we came up with is shall be no more than 800 square feet in size. We talked about the possibility of a range or percentage, but that's where we landed at this point in time. We have provisions for water supply and sewage disposal. We're going to have to discuss with DPW a little more. They worked with us on that. And there's a few concerns that the board had with that. We're going to be working out those shortly. In terms of dimensional requirements, any ADU has to be consistent or conforming to the dimensional requirements that we have in the zoning ordinance. One concern that we have is those RA and RAA zones. A lot of instances you have lots that are existing lots of record that are smaller than the minimum size that's allowed today. In those instances, if the accessory dwelling unit expands the footprint of the principal dwelling, we have it where those lots wouldn't be eligible for an accessory dwelling unit if they're creating an expansion like that of a lot that's a pre-existing lot of record. Sprinkler system requirement for situations with three or more stories, and condominium conversion, it's not eligible for condominium conversion. Impact fees would be the same as an impact fee for a duplex right now. We'd charge that same impact fee for that accessory dwelling unit. And the removal of the accessory dwelling unit would require a change of use from the planning board and building permit from the building department. We also have parking requirements that it has to meet the parking standards that we have in place for the ADU as well as the primary unit. And then in Article 7, we amended that to incorporate the exterior design that we talked about that maintains the look and feel of a single family home, and we think this accomplishes that. So it's a lot there. It's a large ordinance, a lot of work. Several meetings went into it. I don't know if Mark wants to add anything to what I've said.
Obviously, this has been a difficult prospect for the planning board, which recognized early on that this particular one-size-fits-all approach it's essentially a statewide zoning ordinance does not really fit well in Hampton or in other beach communities that have beach districts. And that's been recognized by Rockingham Planning Commission. There are other parts of the state that have similar problems. And so there are some probable in the future legislative changes that will come along to recognize and deal with these, but for the moment we're doing the best we can. The planning board has met four times on this and has had some very extensive discussions about the various factors that you now see, and will again. This will be posted for a public hearing soon after the planning board gets one more look at the latest
right.
draft.
They're looking for one more review.
But obviously a lot of work has gone into this. Jason has attended a number of different conferences where this has been discussed. Mm-hmm. The Rockingham Planning Commission has been quite active in developing the model ordinance and in pointing out the problems. So it's a new subject for the entire state, and we've been dealing with it quite comprehensively and the best we can.
Any questions you have?
Gina?
Yeah, I really want to congratulate the planning board, because I read through this afternoon, and when I first heard of this bill, it, you know, initially made me very nervous because mm-hmm. it had a chance of changing the characteristic of
absolutely
the whole town. And I think what the planning board has done, requiring that an owner be there, the principal resident, and keeping, you know, the original footprint, I think it's a great job. And I don't have any questions. I'm glad that we have a great planning board, and I'm glad that you're a town planner.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I've also paid a lot of attention to it, and I think I understand it, but I am going to ask some questions, because these are questions that people have asked me, and I want them to be able to hear
sure.
Your response. Obviously, you did say the people don't have to be related.
Yeah, you can't require a familial relationship according to the new law.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct.
And is when this is all done, will Hampton's law be different from the intent that the state had to begin with?
I think, well, we have to work within the parameters of what we're provided by the state. So I think that...
But you will be able to make tweaks to it.
Well, certainly. And I think, as Mark said, the legislation itself down the road may change, and that'll give us maybe some more flexibility as it, you know...
But the Hampton Planning Board basically has to stick with the intent of this statewide...
Correct.
Yes.
That's correct.
Do there have to be further exits? Like, let's say the accessory dwelling unit was on the third floor,
mm-hmm.
And the primary exits were on the second floor. Mm-hmm. Like, would they be able to make their entrance, like, to the second floor, and still there would only be two exits on the second floor, which the homeowner had to begin with? I mean, let's say if the homeowner was living on the second floor,
mm-hmm.
and they had their exits were on the second floor,
mm-hmm.
and their accessory dwelling unit was on the third floor,
mm-hmm.
would those the first unit, you know, on the second floor, would the exits and the entrances be acceptable for both the accessory dwelling unit and the primary residence space?
That's a good question, and I think that, you know, it does talk about having, I believe it has to have its a common door between the two units, but I know it's a different situation if you're talking one above the other. There might be instances where there is an exterior staircase or something, but it's not visible from the road, so you're not talking about something that makes the house look any different.
So there are, what if the primary staircase was on the second floor?
Right.
That goes to this dwelling unit. But those are where the exits were, too.
Right.
So ordinarily, if there was another apartment above that, you would have to have two more exits.
Right. But you would still have to comply with whatever is required by building code, I'm sure, in terms of having proper ingress and egress.
But I would think. For a primary resident that was entering on the second floor, right. that would suffice.
Sure.
The two exits.
Correct.
And what would happen if it's a mixed-use building?
Okay. I mean, I think it's designed more for those instances where you have a single-family home and somebody wants to add that unit to their single-family home. I think that's...
Well, there are a lot of single-family homes that have businesses in them. That's right. What a mixed-use business. That's what a mixed-use building is.
Right.
How
Absolutely.
Does the state deal with that right at the present?
That's a good question. That's one that I don't think we've really.
Well, Hampton's filled with places.
Absolutely. I think it's
so. That's going to be very, very important.
We're going to take a look at that. That's a good question.
I've already been contacted by three people that have that exact issue.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it's long term that it's been that way.
Okay.
So I know that as far as insurance company is concerned, that it's not a commercial building if the commercial space is 25% or less.
Okay.
And that is true also for the flood insurance policies.
Yep. Okay.
So I would like to know how the state deals with this, with the way they already have it written. I would like a response. I'm not necessarily now, but if you could get that back to me, I have some anxious people wanting to know.
I think that's a very good question. It's not something that's really, in all the discussions and meetings we've attended, this has never come up, and that's a very good point, so we will look at that for you.
Yeah, because that is what you're going to find a lot of in Hampton.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep, you're welcome.
Thank you. I'd just like to reiterate that when this law was first passed, that the town attorney, the town planner, picked up on it immediately and began to work with it, and that in conjunction with the planning board has done a lot of work on this issue, and Rick's questions are really good, and I'm sure Jason will bring those back, and Mark, and I'm sure that they'll work on those.
We will, absolutely. So
the people that I'm talking about, all of them are on normal-sized lots.
Yep.
And they're probably business seasonal lots.
Yep.
I would assume.
And you will be posting when the public hearings are.
Sure, that's right. The planning board will see it at least one more time before there is a public hearing. I would imagine maybe the first public hearing might be the first meeting in December. I'm just estimating, but they'll be posted for public hearing. Copies of the ordinance will be available for people to view prior to that as well.
Okay, and those will be posted on the website.
We can put them on, like we've done in the past, we can put them on the website and have a copy in the planning office for people to view.
Okay, so people can see them
there.
That's
right, yep.
Okay, very good. Any other questions? Thank you very much,
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you do a great job.
Okay,
I have to say that. Thank you very much. It's so much easier than it's been in past years having you here.
Excellent. Next, Christy, William, Finance Director, Monthly Financials. Seems like you're here every week.
I am. It's budget season, my favorite time of year.
I thought you liked fall.
I'm here with the September financials. It's the ninth report of the month of the year, and the target is 75%. So we're 3/4 of the way done. It's crazy to think that. The month's total income was $505,087. Motor vehicles came in at $356,155, which is over the adjusted month's target by $100,580. The other major contributors to the month's total were interest on taxes at $19,465, building permits at $20,851. Departmental income at $54,528, parking lots at $27,964, district court fines at $18,327, and real estate trust at $128,851. I did point out there that that's for August and September. August income ended up in our spam, so we hadn't seen that money had come in when I did the August financials. You'll notice that the 2016 adjusted budget column has been updated and now reflects the estimated revenues, which are $7,612,533. So estimated revenues are due to the state on September 1st and are used when the tax rate is set, so I made sure I updated the revenue report so that it reflects that. Expense summary shows the year-to-date expenses by department. At the end of September, the operating departments without debt service but with open POs were 72.04% of the budget, which is under the month's target by 2.96% or $713,786. When you compare this to September of 2015, we were at 74.69% spent in 72.04 in 2016. Overall, the departments as a whole are running under the target of 75%. The town clerk is at 75.37%, which is related to their computer support, but that's a one-time bill. Once a year, we pay for the support for that. MIS, which is the computer department, is at 64.6%. A few line items in this section are over the target of 75%. The first one is staff development, and this is related to the members of the department recently taking courses related to IT. They both, one of them just finished, and the other one is going in the next couple of weeks. The other line items, supplies and expenses, because items are being charged to the proper line. I made adjustments in the 2017 when I proposed that budget to you. There needed to be a lot of moving of funds in that department so that we can accurately reflect where money is being spent. And so hopefully next year we won't run into this problem where line items are over. On page 3, the legal as a whole is under the target. The only line item here that is over is outside counsel fees, is at 102%. Cemeteries as a whole is under target. Some accounts to note there are telephone at 118.28% and heating fuel is at 100%. Parking administration is at 104%. There are a few concerts left, so this section will end up over budget. The police department is at 74.71% when you include the open purchase orders that they have. Some accounts to note here are under administration, OT wages, and computer support. Under traffic control and patrol, the sick leave wages and the uniform allowance. Under support services, summer coverage, full-time, OT wages, OT training wages and vacation wages, and under station and buildings, the OT wages are over. The fire department is at 71.48% when you include their open purchase orders. Some accounts to note here are under administration, staff development, under fire suppression, the OT wages, and under repair services, OT wages. Hydrants is at 97.03%. We've paid both the bills there, so that line item shouldn't change again this year. Department of Public Works is at 67.53% when you include the open purchase orders. Some accounts to note here are under highways and streets, the admin OT wages, water, rentals and leases, supplies and expenses, under street lighting, traffic light repairs, under municipal sanitation, the administration section, hired equipment summer, under the solid waste collection, OT wages, under landfill operations, the groundwater monitoring, under the transfer station, OT wages, staff development, repairs and maintenance, hired equipment summer, supplies and expenses, and under repairs and maintenance, the sewer line maintenance. Mosquito control is at 91.97%. I think when Ann was in here doing her budget, she said they might have one more small bill, so they'll probably end up under budget there. Welfare is at 69.24. The line item to note there is the public assistance rent. We talked about that also, that line has really skyrocketed this year, and she expects it to continue. Culture and recreation is at 66.52%. Some accounts to note here are under administration, the OT wages, and under maintenance of parks, the grounds and fields. Patriotic purposes is at 114.73%. The warrant articles at the town meeting, a lot of those projects are well underway and have been expended at this point. The 2015 encumbrances are showing that 88% have been expended to date, so we've almost cleared out all of those purchase orders. And then when you get to the special revenue funds, Fund 24, the recreation, the fund balance is $163,665. The beach sticker donations year-to-date total $15,180, with $16,442 being granted in scholarships so far this year. The cable committee fund balance is at $182,796. Fund 26 for private detail, the current fund balance is at $92,510. Fund 27, which is the EMS fund, the balance is at $314,315. And wastewater system development charges, the fees collected in 2016 so far total $51,612. And the balance in the account is $166,274. So that is the exciting financials for September.
Regina.
Yes, so we have spent 88% of the 2015 encumbrances.
Yes.
All our major departments are still under 75%. Yes. And overall, we're at 68.4% of our 2016 use budget. Is that correct?
72.04.
Oh, 72.04?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was looking at the total, not the operating.
Yep.
Which is slightly down from last year. So I say we're right on target.
Yep.
All right. Great. Thank
Doing
you.
Good.
No questions. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Chrissy, just a couple of things. Is this report online?
It should be. I believe I sent it to people.
If somebody wanted to look at the monthly reports, they could see it online, right?
Yes. It's under, if you go to departments and do finance, all the monthly financials are up there.
Okay.
And they have a couple years, going back a couple years, usually. Right.
And they could see the figures and everything else?
Yes.
Yeah, so because sometimes people say, you know, when we talk here, we talk percentages, and they don't know what the figures are. So they can go and look at this and see it, which is really, really good.
And it'll have the narrative. It'll be in the same exact format that your packets are in front of you if someone wants to look at it.
Right.
So it starts with a narrative, then has revenue, and all followed by expenses.
And can you maybe, for the public, that when you talk about funds, Fund 24, Fund 25, can you just briefly say what that is? Public might not understand what those are.
Fund 24 is the recreation fund, and Fund 25 is cable.
And how are those funded?
Oh, those are funded through their own mechanisms. So Fund 24 is literally funded through the people who pay for the programs.
Okay, so that's not
tax. No tax dollars for any of those funds. No tax dollars are raised.
And the cable committee is not tax money. That's
correct. It's from the franchise fees from Comcast funds channel 22, which is Fund 25. And private details are funded through when the officers perform the private details, we charge the companies a 30% administrative fee, plus we charge them to cover the wages that are spent for the officers who are doing the details. And the EMS is through the ambulance billing.
Okay, and the wastewater system development?
Wastewater system development charge is a charge assessed by the public works director when a dwelling unit increases the use to the sewer system.
Okay, good. Great. Just so people understand what we're talking about. And you're really on top of it. I mean, we know, you know every month exactly what's being spent by whom, right?
Yes.
It's very good. Very good report.
I look at the bills every week.
I have one more question.
Yeah.
So what is the parking now to this point of the year compared to last year?
Parking compared to last year. Let's see. I think it's just slightly over. Let me just check real quick here, though. Parking lots, I only have the 16 budget on here. I don't have the actuals for the parking lots on here, on this report. I'd have to look it up and see. I think when Diana was here last week, though, she did say that they were slightly over. Not by a lot, though, I don't believe.
But they are over in their...
I believe that they are over what we took in for revenue in 2015.
Okay.
I can look that up, though. And I'll be here next week, too, so I can report it back to you if you like when I'm here.
Perfect.
So.
Thank you. And I think it's probably the just about the end of it by next year anyway. I mean, next week.
Yeah, I think we...
There shouldn't be a lot more.
Right. I think that when she was here last week, she said there was only a few more concerts left, like a handful, I believe, of concerts left. So we're definitely winding down for sure.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Christy. Next is Bob Dockham on street name. Do you want to join us up here?
Hi, I'm Bob Dockham. This is my wife, Kathy.
I just have some
thank you.
Pamphlet.
what she's passing out is the minutes when the name of the street was okayed and discussed at the Board of Selectmen in 2014, a little over two years ago. You can see that number one choice, Magnolia Way, Harmony Drive, and Robertson Way. And then highlighted on the next page was where it was brought up for both Wanda and Bernie Robertson. And was voted on and seconded by Mr. Waddell. In the meantime, on the next page, there are some of those roads are private, as we found out in the last meeting that I attended approximately a couple of months ago, with very similar sounding names, which is part of the problem for because this has been brought up as an issue because of 911 and the clarity of being able to respond to the right address, I assume, is the problem. So there's some names that are on the in the town that are very similar sounding. And then also on the last sheet are just some other road names that are nothing to do with what the town has adopted to name roads after veterans that have passed. Obviously, Wanda wasn't a veteran, but she did work for the town. And no disrespect from me whatsoever for any of these people. But obviously, these names are not the best of names and choices for road names. We were given another list, which were the same names that I was given originally 2 years ago. I was also told that Sweat Road or Sweat Drive. Was already handed out in the subdivision?
I believe that that has been handed out for a subdivision off of Timber Swamp Road.
It's private line, and it means because it has three addresses.
Yeah, and I think that this Robertson Drive was the first one that wasn't named after a veteran in recent memory.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. This the very first one.
And I made a suggestion the last time here. If I don't know how the town feels about maybe a B Robertson so that we didn't have to change everything. I don't think W would sound like it's West, and that would be confusing, I would think. So I figured B, or maybe even back to one of these other names like Magnolia, that there isn't one in town anyway. Obviously, in that last meeting, Fred had mentioned that he was going to try and come up with some names, but there weren't a lot of new names to or names to come up with. So I just had a suggestion if we had to change it, if it couldn't go to just a B Robertson, that maybe would help with 911. I don't know how distinctive that is for 911. I don't not think anyone's here to talk to that, but...
Fred, do you have an opinion on that?
Any name you want, we'll just run it through 911 and make sure it's okay. We did, one of the suggestions Public Works came up with was an extensive list of former presidents, which we don't have any presidential names in town, obviously.
Trump?
Not a former president.
I had to break it up a little bit.
That was very good. That was excellent. Very good. But yeah, I mean, we have a lot of...
Drumped.
Did you say dumped?
Make it confused with the dump.
Oh, okay. That's possible. We don't have a dump road.
That is his real name, Drump.
Oh, okay. It's that German spelling.
One of my other big concerns in figuring this out is currently finished up with one what I'm calling one Robertson, Lot 1, and the owners are taking... ownership of that closing. As of Friday, closing Friday, and they need mailing address. And not only that, but I spoke with Kevin, the building inspector, and he can't make out a CO to
he has address for
someplace
it.
He doesn't have an address for.
Right.
And we also have closing documents and HUD statements and deeds and everything else that we can't do because of the name.
I don't think anything comes close to Magnolia in the town.
Right. Yeah. So we could go with Magnolia.
You could very well.
If that was...
That's what we...
I know, but I personally feel that this has to be discussed by the board. There has to be more of, more members here, really. I think
the only problem is if they need
okay,
to have
well, you know what? I don't go for that. It's too bad that it's that way, but...
Well, I can't...
Well, the only thing is this is... I mean, this was back in September of 2014 that Selectman... Woosley talked about Captain Bernie Robertson. Selectman Bridle said that you know, they don't have
I understand.
A
trust me, I was here. I just don't think it's fair to drop this and to change the whole policy without having the other people fit in. Otherwise, let's come up with a serviceman, which is the policy now. And I'm sure there's somebody from the French Indian War or wherever else.
So is it that Robertson
I don't like
is-
any of your arguments, and I'm the one that voted against it being Wanda Robinson Road. Mm-hmm. But I don't, just because of the name, and you know what? I love Magnolia, but I don't think that that has any sense to what we're doing here.
And I feel bad, and I totally
understand it, and I don't even know why you had to come back and ask another time. Mm-hmm. I think it should have been handled back in when you came in the first time. That's why I voted against it. Mm-hmm.
Is it that Robertson is close to Roberts Road or Drive? Or?
Yeah, 911 said it was too close to Roberts.
Now, all these other ones that I had a list of,
I agree.
I mean, I don't know. Yeah, have a lot that are...
We have two employees that we have a record of it who have passed away as employees. One was Daniel McCarron, and the other was Wanda Robinson, for which a street has not been named. We had a fire employee who passed away, and a street has been named for him. We have a, let's go back in history, we have a James Fair, a private, Civil War.
Like Ferry Road.
Edward Colcord, King Philip's War. Hilliard's already taken.
I know. See, these people aren't happy either, so that's why.
We have a Lieutenant Robinson that passed away in King Philip's War, and we have a Captain Benjamin Sweat that passed away in King Philip's War. That's 1677. It's a couple of days ago.
Well, Sweat is a big name in New Hampshire, as is McCarron.
Yes.
I'm in favor of either one of those.
What happens with all these other ones that are so similar with the 911?
I don't know. That's a good question.
Well, We have to
make a submission. The roads that are currently there are currently there. Mm-hmm. What they've done in a couple of cases in other towns is they've sent a letter to the Board of Selectmen saying all the following names must be changed. And they've done that in several towns where they've gone back in and redone all the roads. They haven't done that in Hampton. I suspect that would be a problem that the board may very well say, yeah, well, tough luck.
How is Sweat spelled? S-W-E-T-T?
Yep.
Yeah. How many close roads are there to that?
Probably
there
none.
There aren't, as far as I can tell.
Long Timber Swamp is already named.
His name what?
Sweat.
Oh, there is a private road. Yeah.
That's a private road. Well, take McCarron. It's another town employee.
It is.
That passed on.
McCarron.
And it's a nice name. It's like McCarron Airport in Las Vegas.
Haven't been there.
I make a motion that we name the road McCarron.
Yeah, I mean, that sticks to what the board
motion.
Was. I'm in. Yeah. Any discussion?
Any discussion on it? All in favor? Is that?
Is that?
Here we go. Here he is.
The question is, is that okay with the owners?
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Obviously, I mean, it's better. Ideally, it would be better to stay at Robertson because of all of our legal documents.
Sure.
So I don't know. I don't really know what happens in that case personally with everything that's already been done with the registry as far as closings. And I don't really know how deeds work and all that if it's already under a different name.
If it's already in documents, it'd have to probably be changed. Some of them would have to be changed in order to specify titles and continuation of the title itself and so forth. So I don't know how serious that is. I mean, the lawyer would have to tell you. But it could be confusing.
So how do we handle that at this point? I mean, well, especially moving forward with closing and
we have
documents.
A motion right now here to do it if you want to have McCarron.
How is that spelled? M-C-C-A-R-E-N?
Got to get to the right page. Got too many pages. It's M-C capital C-A-R-R-O-N.
I guess.
Yeah. Now, we do this, we vote on it.
Is it McCarron Drive, Way, Street, Road?
Could it be a drive? I think drive sounds better.
Yeah.
Yeah. It can be either. Any one of the three.
All right, so we have a motion. We have a second. Mr. Bean?
Sir.
We're discussing the street name.
I'm on board. I'll go with the majority. Thank you.
Okay. We ready for a vote?
I think so.
And it, when we vote on this now, that's the name they've got. I mean, because the people want to close it, they want to do their business, they want, and it's not fair of us to hold them up.
No, we don't want to do that.
You know, we got to allow them.
What we need to do is come up with another list now of the, that's prioritized.
Yeah, right. Because most of these names
and that's
are
what we've
similar.
Always have right. dealt with.
Okay, right. But I'm saying we need to move forward on this and allow them to do what they need to do.
Right.
Okay, so you have a motion, a second.
Okay, all in favor? It's unanimous.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So as far as the CO paperwork, I just changed that from Robertson to McCarran.
To McCarran.
Okay. Yeah, and drive sounded good to you, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Just drive to make sure
drive it is.
Sounds roll, yeah. It sounds good. Like some high rollers from Vegas might be coming.
Can I borrow your pen? Because
oh, sure.
Before I leave, I just want to make sure I have the spelling right.
Yeah.
Capital M C. Capital C A R R O N.
C A R R O N.
Drive.
Right.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next on the agenda is budget reviews, Department of Public Works. Are you asleep?
No. He'd like to be.
I thought there was a sweat road. I knew it sounded familiar.
It's a private drive off the timber.
Yeah. It's a private road.
Yeah. I remember seeing the sign.
I don't think it's up yet.
Oh, there isn't? Well,
I don't think it's up yet.
I saw someone's address or something.
Good evening.
Good evening. And we know who everybody is, but just say your name so the public knows.
Teresa McGinnis, Operations Coordinator for the Public Works Department.
Chris Jacobs, Director of Public Works.
Jen Hale, Deputy Director of Public Works.
Mike Duby, Wastewater Operations.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We collectively have gone over our budget a number of times trying to anticipate maybe some of the questions or, and every year we always ask this more procedural question, would you like us to just go down through and highlight the major changes or do you want the quick and dirty? What's the board's purview?
You know, I think the people at home like to hear as much as possible.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we have the time. We don't want to get into the total weeds of everything.
Right.
But, you know, if you can go over what the changes are, what some of the figures are, I think that would be good. Is that agreeable to everybody else?
Sure. Okay.
Here's the detail.
Then, I hope everyone's got with them. There's the actual budget, and then there's the attached detail sheet, which a number of us are going to refer to help jog our memories as to what some of these things are. Probably, and I'm going to start with under our operating budget by expense. This would be under the 4311 highways. And streets, start right off with the administration line. Regular wages are down by 0.79%. We've requested $1,084,938 and been granted that through the manager's review. It's slightly less than the $1,093,000 last year. It isn't due to that we've laid anybody off. They're just salary adjustments. Several people have retired. We've had new people replace other people at the lower starting wage rates that are listed in the collective bargaining agreements. Part-time wages has gone up 14.5%, and I have a little note down to tells me to allow Teresa to explain why that occurred.
Part of that reason is we moved $5,000 from the engineering account, which is a little bit further down, to pay for a summer intern in engineering. when we talked to the town manager, the past 2 years we've had it in the engineering account, but they preferred that it be moved to wages as it's being spent on wages. So we further down, you'll notice a $5,000 decrease in that the engineering account. Also, COLAs and step increases are reflected in their overtime wages, which causes it to go up incrementally. So that's the reasons for the increase in that account.
Okay. I'm just going to jump down through the, you know, career incentives have stayed the same. Our telephones, let's see, that's gone up 5.6%. It has to do with some of the tablets that we're going to be acquiring for running our asset management system. Let's see, heating fuel, if I'm reading this right, it's taken a 7.4% decline. Mm-hmm. Just better tracking, better numbers of what we're doing. The one line that, you know, if you were to look at the percentage increases on the right side, rentals and leases, gone from a whopping $350 request last year to a $750. It's only because we have been transporting, when we say rentals and leases, one of the biggest issues we have is if we have a large piece of equipment, like one of the cat loaders or something like that, that needs to go back to Milton Cat for work, repair work or annual maintenance outside of what we can do, the $300 haul fee comes out of that particular line. So it doesn't take but one or two hauls, and this year alone we're up to 642 in that line. So that's more of a, as I said last year, a truth in spending adjustment than it is more than anything else. Building maintenance is we're asking for a, let's see if I'm reading this right. Yeah, sorry. Supplies and expenses has gone up almost 8,000, a 20% increase. As you can see, so far we've spent 22. Our line is actually 25. In the previous year, we spent 50,000. This goes to we have a metal building. The original was built in 67 with the addition in 87. Am I doing right? Closely?
Yeah.
Okay. Like, for instance, this year we had the end of the building closest to the marsh, all the siding replaced because it had literally rotted off the building. The last 3 inches was not there. The moisture that comes off the marsh every day and morning during the summer is laden with salt, and it is eroding the building. We've painted the west end, the opposite end of the building, and we've had a bunch of roof work done to keep the ceiling from, you know, leaks from coming in the maintenance space. It hadn't really been done previously, so we're hoping to do a little more of it every single year rather than hit the town with, let's say, a new building. Rather than, you know, I personally don't like seeing things go rust or decay around us. I think we owe it to the public to do a better job in maintenance, and that's why there's that 8% increase. So under the next line, building maintenance is strictly 20,000 is what we're asking this year. We asked 10 last year, and we have spent 20,883 to date this year. Let's see, diesel fuel is gasoline's a negative 5.6. There again, better tracking in that WEX card that the town obtained for us last year. And diesel fuel is down 28%, which has been a good deal. The biggest increase under this whole section is for that federal stormwater requirements. Jennifer and I regularly attend our SECO Stormwater Alliance meetings. It has been told by Newton Tedder, who works for the EPA, that the permit will come out after the November election, but before the president gets sworn in, the new president gets sworn in. We'll all be caught up in the excitement of a new president, and that will soften the landing on this stormwater compliance. to be honest with you, we haven't sat back lightly on this. That's what partly our asset management software purchase is going to be about. But we are asking for $50,000 in this year's coming budget, where we were granted $10,000 last year. And I know I've sat here multiple times and told you it's coming, because I've been told it's coming. But last year, Massachusetts was given their permit in a draft format with a 6-month get used to it and another 6-month ramp up period, and then it becomes permanent. Well, the same thing is going to happen to us. And I would say the writing is definitely on the wall. Let's see. I'll go down to the bottom of the page. Engineering services, we are showing a 12% decrease, but as Teresa explained, it's merely a moving $5,000 out of that engineering budget up to
seasonal wages.
Seasonal wages, thank you. I think of all the fun stuff. I'm going to the next page. I'm glad to see that there's a lot of zeros and only a 1.65 increase in repairs and maintenance, and that's buildings wide. If I can check my line. Yeah, repairs and maintenance is, it's actually under the paving and reconstruction, right? It's highways, again, 22,000 in there for resurfacing, some patchwork, 13.5, screen gravel that we buy every year. And then we have three contracts that we have every year. Line painting, the crosswalk and traffic markings, and weed control. I can say that we're doing a better job with line painting, as in maintaining what we have, but I do know that I'm seeing that the number of linear feet of line painting increase. More people are, as the population ages, are insisting on the white fog lines on the side of the road where we may not have had any of them before. We're painting out more crosswalks for traffic safety. And we are adding to, it seems every year there's a slight addition to the weed control budget. What that's for is, I don't know if everyone knows, we hire an outside firm, they go down through town and actually treat all the sidewalks against weed growth. We also use them up in the landfill. They keep, if you've been up there, you see, or drive by, you see this nice stone swales coming down off the side of the landfill. It isn't by a miracle that they stay weed free. It's due to the efforts of this company here. So we do use them in a number of places to keep back the poison ivy and keep back the weeds. I wish they had intervened on the poison ivy at my place. I wouldn't be wearing this little wristband at the moment. So that, I am seeing a slight increase in those lines. But I would have to say that it's a level of service back to the residents. It's been requested. It's like lawns. Now can you mow this? Can you mow that? And that account also changes. Moving on, let's see. Lawn care does stay the same. Hired equipment stays the same as last year, as does tree maintenance. I would like to say I had earlier this summer given to Fred a listing. We're up to close to 40 trees having been removed already this year. I know of at least 6 to 8 others that have been identified and are scheduled to be removed. These are trees that are totally dead. There's one out on Exeter Road. I couldn't get over how many holes are in it. It's a wonder it didn't blow down before. And we've also trimmed back branches on at least a dozen trees. So I will be giving to the budget committee verification of that. And we've been keeping track of it. Actually, I have a tree maintenance list where the trees were cut, when they were cut, and how much we paid for them. And we're getting good service with our vendor. And we're staying on top of it. We're doing the work that account is supposed to be done. I know it shows actually $8,880. I know it's well over, I've signed well over $10,000 or $12,000 worth of tree invoices. so that there's more going to be coming out of that account. Street signs, we're still in the process of trying to stay on top of them. I had a discussion with Fred. We are going to be ordering new street signs. We're going to get the town seal actually embossed on the part of the street sign. And for the general public, all the street signs that have 4-inch letters still have to be upgraded to 6-inch letters. It's supposed to be by the end of next year, but I haven't seen anybody jumping all over us for that. Working our way down, storm drainage and drainage construction in general is staying the same at the request of $30,000 each. Sidewalks, again, we're staying with the $26,000. We've just completed a project on High Street. Several sections, Jen headed it up. We had to bid the project twice to get a contractor in, but we were successful to finally find one that wanted to work with us. And I don't mean that in a derogatory sense. They just have so much work out there. So we were finally able to talk someone into giving us a price, and it was a fair price, and we got some of the work done. Handicaps were ramps replaced or installed where there were none, and so we're liking to continue with that same number. We could always use more, but I think we're going to rely on a warrant article process again like we did last year, because we have more sidewalks in need than we have budget. Sand and salt, just going to snow and ice removal, all those lines we're requesting to stay the same. We've got our toes and fingers crossed that we'll have a equally mild winter as in last year. So we've got $67,860 for wages, $30,000 for hired equipment, salt at $80,000, and sand at $13,877. I know I'm going to get asked, how come I haven't bought any sand? It's because I have enough in the pile right now. But I can say that for that $13,000, it's good insurance money. If it does become a difficult winter, i.e. cold temperatures and a lot of pack being on the side streets, sand is the primary thing we use to prevent the water from being contaminated with salt and to give the traction where we need it on the side roads. So I could go through, I've seen it in the past, where we literally could go through half of our sand in one winter. Just depends on what kind of winter it is. So I would respectfully request that, and you haven't, the administration has left it in there, that we not trim that budget line. Municipal sanitation. Let's see, my notes even say, see the backup. Overtime wages. I'm going to give that a, you know more on the wages.
Overtime.
Ooh, yes, thank you.
Hang on 1 second, please. Overtime wages. Okay, for the most part, that increase is due to the base wages being increased for COLAs and step increases, and that is reflected upwards in the increase in overtime wages, and based on need for that section. They have to work every holiday. They have to work every Saturday and every Sunday by state and federal law, because the tests have to be done. So it's work that has to be accomplished, and that's the only way it can be done, because the testing has to occur every day of the week, every day of the year. So that's the explanation for the increase in that account.
And we've actually, Teresa's actually prepared as part of the budget detail on this page 48 of the budget detail. Actually, you know, the 52 Saturdays, the 52 Sundays, the 11 holidays, 80 call-ins. The plan is getting a little bit older internally, and there seems to be more and more things to have to come in after hours for. Pumps shutting off, pumps not working, chlorine not being pumped, etc. We're seeing more and more of that. And then there's 100 hours of miscellaneous overtime wages in there. There's also sewer call-ins, and we do carry $1,700 for RIE, but I want to be clear that we do get reimbursed for that if we bill them. Let's see. The next line that's got a significant increase is the telephone under the wastewater treatment plant. And there again, that has to do with when we go with the tablets, and the tablets should help us with the overtime calls. With the asset management software that we have in place, and it's actually called SCADA within the plant. Right now, for instance, Michael can sit at home, and if there's a call in or alarm, he can literally pop open his laptop, check into the plant, and tell which pump's shut down and which pump's running, maybe which one's overheated. If one's jammed, does he have he has the ability to start and stop pumps remotely from home, and or see whether or not somebody needs to come in 2 hours early, or can it wait till 7 o'clock in the morning. So the two tablets is going to, the whole plan is under the asset management system to expand that so that other people like Steve Aslin, who lives in town, like Carl, who lives in Portsmouth, or I guess he is moving closer, and Rob Pierce are the kind of people that can respond to these things. So we pay a little more for the technology and the phone service to run that technology. Hopefully it saves us on a violation and some overtime calls. Although I know I'm going to have to agree with them if it's a significant amount of computer time to get it. It's a call-in. But if it's a five-minute open it, okay. No big deal. I don't have to go in. And that's what we're hoping to get with that. The other thing, there's a one line that's got a shocking number to it, and it says a 700% increase, and it has to do with the flow meters. It's under hired equipment for wastewater treatment. Mike, did you want to speak to that?
Yeah, that's a requirement that we have to do every year, part of like administrative order that we had back in 2011. Coming into the plant compared to the flow going out, because we don't have an influent flow meter, we have an outgoing flow meter. So,
and it's important, I think, to note that line, although it went up 700%, it only had 200 in it before, and so we're going to 1600. We're not taking it. We're taking the cost of the flow meters to rent it. That's what's getting added to that line.
Is that something you could buy or no?
Doesn't.
Would it be not cost efficient?
Oh, that question, I'll let them answer. It's been.
Yeah, we could purchase it, but the amount of times we sort of use it. But then the equipment would be outdated or old, so.
All right. Everything else within that line appears to be, you know, relatively either down, like gasoline again is down 29%, but one line is up 8.6%. The supplies and expenses. Again, we have some 375 various pieces of equipment, pumps, motors, valves, things that can go wrong. We've actually broken it down by those. So we're looking for a slight increase to go from 67. We have 81,000 in this year's budget. We'd like to go to 88,000. There again, aging plant, and more of these little things are going to come up, and they're going to nag us. So overall, if you look at municipal sanitation, the wastewater treatment plant, it's only a 1% increase. Belabor that. Solid waste collection. Again, we had a great rate last year. We're still seeing the benefit of that. We've got regular wages with only 0.88% increase. Part-time wages, a 1.29% increase. We do have overtime wages increasing 111%, or going from basically 20,000 to 40,000. This has to do with Jim Hafey's?
No. This is rubbish collection on weekends. 5-year average is 37,000. It's just that the number we asked for it to get increased, and it doesn't. So over the past 3 or 4 years, it stays the same. So every year we ask for more, and it just every year they get a COLA or a step increases. It increases the overtime rate as well. So it's based on need, on the hours that they actually work on the weekends, collecting trash in the summertime.
And there again, on the summary that Teresa prepared, all the staff prepared, it's, you know, 3 holidays, 16 Saturdays, 16 Sundays in the summer, and the Memorial to Labor Day overtime, 592 hours to collect all that trash. So that's what it's taken to get it done during the summer, especially those 13 weeks. And like Teresa, I said last year, there was always going to be some budget modifications, and this is one of those, as I said, a truth in spending adjustment to the budget, just trying to bring some truth to it. The only other thing that I can see that's making a marked increase is the 14.5%, and that has to do with diesel fuel. Got budgeted 39.6. Easily gone through over half of that, and but we're recommending 45.355. There again, when I'm here with you and we go over the cart collection policy back to the condos and who do we give carts to and who don't we, this is one of those lines that indirectly, when we make those kinds of decisions up or down, is affected by the diesel lines, because more carts is just literally going to take more fuel. It's more stops, it's more acceleration, more deacceleration, it's more if they fill up, and like when I told you last month, okay, trash is up 31 tons. Well, when each truck only holds a couple of tons, it's more runs back to the transfer station. So this is a line that I don't like it when it goes up, but it's, I'd say it's a sign of a good economy if it does go up. And it's a necessary line. It's one of those lines that year in and year out, if I was continually only given 39,603, would I exceed that line? Yeah. Because it's out there and you have to pick it up. It's a health issue. So I think we're just trying to bring that one more into truth in what we actually are going to be using. Landfill operations, no changes there. We're under a multi-year contract for landfill monitoring, groundwater monitoring, and the landfill maintenance. Waste tipping fees, we are seeing a 1% increase in waste tipping. We got a really great rate last year. It does go up by cost of living adjustment. I think it went up a quarter a ton. And it, in the end, it, based upon the tonnage that we collect, it's going to raise that whole line by 1%. Same thing with the hauling. They got a 4% increase in their contract. And when we back figure the number of tons to the increase, it's 2.87. It's, again, a contractual number. Transfer station, we're seeing the regular wages tick up by 1.97%. Again, a contractual thing. The part-time wages went down by 68%. But don't hold your breath, the overtime wages went up by 31%. Reason being is we used to have a part-time worker who only came in 3 weekends out of 4 in a month, ran the transfer station for us. He found another job, could no longer come in there. We looked back again at the contract with the Teamsters. It didn't allow for that to continue. We went back and within the Teamsters contract, and that's the overtime that it's going to take for the weekends to fulfill that portion of the contract. It just really is staffing time. That's it. Is there more to that? Did I miss something on
no,
that?
That'd okay. Be good.
I have these three here to keep me in line, and if I get off track, they're supposed to kick me? No. Okay. I will turn one other line over to Teresa, staff development. We're going from an approved line of 1350 to 2660, and it has to do with training.
We have 28 employees that have to have their solid waste operator certificate renewed every year at $50 a piece, and every other year the Waymasters have to have theirs renewed. And in 2017, we have 14 employees who have to have their Waymaster certification renewed at $90 a piece. So that's the increase, $1,200.
Is that annually or was it biannually?
Biannually for Waymasters.
Right, so you might see a decrease in this line next year.
Next year, there'll be a
then
decrease.
Then back up the following year, then back down.
And there's no training involved in that, so it's just a $90 renewal fee.
A number of the other lines are still staying the same. The electric, heating, fuel, water, they're all staying the same. Transfer station repairs and maintenance has gone up 250, or projected to request to go up to 250%, and Jennifer's noted here to fill you in as to why.
Basically, on this one, the repairs and maintenance obviously stem from the building itself. There's interior and exterior cleaning that needs to occur. It happens daily. There's things that need to be painted. The scale house has to be maintained, recertified. But really what is making the difference here is the retaining wall that is there currently. Under this year's budget, shortly, there's two blocks that we're replacing. If you haven't been there lately, there's some movement happening. We've had someone come in and look at it to get us the two blocks to make the repair. We're confident there, but when we were up there, it's time to take a look at the whole wall system, not just the one side where we saw the slight repair, but there's evidence of some slight overturning in those type of things. So we've put in the budget $28,000 to actually bring in a structural engineer, do the right types of testing, similarly to what we're doing at Bicentennial Wall, borings and test pits, to find out what's going on there. Whereas that is where all the construction debris, the big trailers sit underneath, and everybody comes up top, where we want to make safety improvements and do fencing and all these type of things. We need to fix it all at once. So that is the jump in that line.
The next line down is hired equipment for the transfer station, going from a whopping $100 to $500, which is a 400% increase. The reason for requesting that is we realized we're in a tragically unfavorable position. We've had a number of, let's see, we had the roll-off truck die on the side of 101, almost had to have it towed. If the right mechanic, good thing that the right mechanic showed up from the right on-road repair shop, he was actually able to fix it so it could limp back to the maintenance facility. It was still on the outer edge of 101. But we've had incidences where the trailer has been on the side of the road, wheels lock up, things of that nature. If we have one tow with a tight budget, we had no ability to get it. So get either the equipment back here or, let's say, to a Rochester truck repair if we needed to, halfway in between. So more than once, we've actually, as you can see in 2015, we actually spent $505. So we went back to that actual amount, and that's why we're asking for that. Looks like a whopping increase, but it's $400. Transfer station gasoline is only up 6.7%. Diesel fuel is up 24%. Again, it has to do with in part, the volume of the materials that we're handling. We're also handling, I was driving through the yard tonight, I couldn't get over the size of the wood debris area. We do pay to get that chipped, but between that and the compost, we spend a tremendous amount of time actually turning the compost. Our vendor won't take the compost from us unless we keep it turned, and so it's decomposed, and that just takes manpower time, and it takes diesel fuel, and the fact that we have a payloader to do it. So overall, that solid waste disposal is up 7.3%. But as I say, 2% was probably due to salaries. 2% is due to hauling. Things that, as we grow, are inherent in why that line is going to increase. With that, on sewage collection and disposal, I have notes down to like Jennifer to talk about sewer line maintenance.
All right. So this year, if you all recall, we may have spent all our money on a force main. So that means the $130,000 that was in the sewer line was used to repair the force main back in February, March. With that said, we didn't get to what was hopefully planned for this year. And moving forward, when we went to look at the CIP in the upcoming years that we presented, we're just realizing that we're falling behind. So in the CIP, as well as what we're presenting to you and what we'll present to the Budget Committee, is the list of projects that we know need to get done. And the amount that we need to keep increasing this line in order to keep up with the work. Because the current value of $130,000, whether we have used it just for the force main this year, or in reality, if we had gotten to some of the projects like we intended, it's just not enough to keep us moving forward, replacing the old clay pipes, having the backup money for if there's any damages or breaks. So that's the big sewer line maintenance change. And again, we do hope to be each year coming back and asking for a little bit more so we can catch up. The infrastructure is old.
There it is. Supplies and maintenance stays the same. Going down to the last two lines, Exeter Sewer Treatment Agreement stays the same at a $7,000 request. I think it's been the same for the last 5 years that I've been here. And wastewater treatment plant maintenance, we're trying to move from $55,000, which was budgeted last year, to $60,000.
It stems from it's electrical repairs, right. Having money in there where we have to hire an electrician by law.
Yeah, there was in the past we did a lot of things ourselves, and we realized 2 years ago that we weren't keeping people safe, and we weren't doing everything pursuant to code. So now we bid that out. I think Relco is our. And they do a fantastic job for us. Quick response, correct the first time. We never seem to have any issues with the work they do. But we are carrying that in there for that particular line this year. With that, the sum total is sewer treatment budget is only up. Well, it's 8% because of that $5,000. Municipal sanitation is up 5.13%. Of course, that is in part for the waste, solid waste. And the grand total for the department is 4%.
And the grand total is?
The grand total number that we're requesting is, or has been approved through the manager's office, $5,170,402.
Questions, Regina?
So you're requesting $5,174,002, which is a little over $198,000 increase from last year.
Correct.
And within that, you pretty much, like Jen has stated, our infrastructure is very old.
And yeah, we're seeing, well, case in point is, you know, as I said before, it's that you're getting a confluence of everything come and do at the same time. The Lafayette Road sewer that we talked about last year, the Church Street Force Main, repairs in the retaining wall at the transfer station, building maintenance for the outside skin. All these things are coming together at the same time,
right.
And really stressing our ability to maintain at least even what we have.
So, I mean, I think that you as a department and with the help of the town manager have really put together a great budget that is taking that all into consideration. And the increases I see are things that we just really don't have too much control over as far as waste pickup.
Correct.
Over time, like you explained it, and it's explained in the detail.
Yeah. And I mean, tonight, like, for instance, that ADU that you're talking about, and it will be great for the community, especially in the rental market. But what that will mean is more wastewater, more trash. So when we make improvements in the community, there are corresponding results that will happen. And they come downhill to me, and I just have to deal with them. Okay.
And then just one specific question I have on administration under highways and streets, the federal stormwater requirements. Just so if anyone looks, like, this year, yeah, we've only spent $331, but what you're saying is that probably this time next year.
Right. And that 300,
substantially higher.
And that 331, again, is an older number from when these got put together. Since then, there's been equipment purchased to help us do with the testing that is going to be required under the new permit. We were able to get that through one of the vendors that we currently work with at the wastewater treatment plant. It's also part of our stormwater collaborative that I came to the board about to enter in with the Southeast Watershed Alliance and the Stormwater Coalition to put together the guidance documents. So more money has already been spent. By the end of the year, we'll be close to spending what we did have. And we are using the guidance of many others in the community just to come up with the 50. They say it could be hundreds of thousands more.
Thank you. I don't have any questions.
Mr. Bean?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Michael, Jennifer, Teresa, you and your department's doing an extraordinary job. You're our largest budget item. You're an equally important department with any department in the town, and we all commend you for your superlative work, your surge operations in the summer, your surge operations when it rains heavily, your surge operations when it is inclement snow weather, and it is not just population dependent as perhaps other departments are. It's 24/7, it's year round, and it's really remarkable leadership and remarkable performance of duty by you guys. Director, I wanted to just touch briefly, and I don't need a response tonight, is if you could just prepare a position paper for the board, if the board agrees, on how our agreements with municipal users to our system are taxed, if you will, or burdened as we are with increases by virtue of the agreements they have with us. That would be the state of New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
That would be the town of Rye. Any others that are out there?
Those are the two biggies.
Those are the two biggies. We see these increase. We see these costs. We see this force main. These folks have contracts in place. And I would look, and perhaps the board would as well, on what is the end state right now, and any suggestions that you might have that those contracts could be modified, even discussed during an interim basis with these people that piggyback off of our expense, off of our infrastructure, off our taxpayer burden. And if you could get that to us, that would be great if the board has no objection. Thanks. And again, ladies and gentlemen, great job. And please extend that to all your people.
Thank you.
Yes. I don't really think it's, you know, all in all, it's really not that much of an increase considering everything that's been going on. I feel that if there's a little bit more expense picking up the trash, it's there, you know, there's more money coming in exact for that purpose. And, you know, things do go up, just like the employees, pay scale goes up. Mm-hmm. So things do go up. And I think it's something we have to address. We want to make sure that Hampton continues to have the same level of services that they have. Otherwise, that needs to really be explained. And, I feel that you're all doing a good job. One thing that troubles me, and it's not a big thing, But you mentioned that you're taking down 40 trees.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be at a cost of $10,000 to $12,000. I'd like to see a point arrive for the town that when they're going to take 40 trees down, they put some more up. If they can spend $10,000 to $12,000 to pay someone to take them out, we should be able to spend $10,000 to $12,000 to put some new trees in. A tree, from what I've been told recently, and I don't know if this is true, but I've heard several people say it this way, one tree makes oxygen for four people. And, you know, we need those trees to be sucking up water. That's a good thing that they do. Some, you know, these dead trees are falling down because they're not, I don't know exactly how it works, if they get waterlogged or whatever, just plain diseased. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that we should think of some way, every tree that's taken down can't be put up again because there may be some reason why it's coming through the sidewalk or something like that. Mm-hmm. But like a golf course, you can put another one close by, you know, when you're playing in a ball and it doesn't quite go in the hole.
Yep.
I mean, we should be doing something.
We have had the discussion that the ones that I took down in Founders Park, Parr Park, Lock Road Park, and a few other locations should be replaced. I was hoping to put them together as one contract. As we got down here into the winter, you know, specify the trees and the location, have a couple people bid on it, and then get it, encumber the money and get it done in the spring.
Yeah, because whether this should be part of your budget or whether it should be some type of a warrant article, a lot of people spoke very strongly when they saw that the trees were tagged.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you look back upon the history of Hampton, already there's so many trees that aren't here anymore. And we need to be planting trees where they're being taken out. I think the water, the benefits that come from helping water stay off the roads, all of that, not to mention the oxygen, you know, we need to plan for the future.
I agree.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. You've done a good job of explaining your budget, I think, really well. You know, I think especially the things like the building maintenance that you talked about, that, you know, if you don't do it, you're going to pay for it in the end.
Right.
I mean, one of the problems is that we haven't stayed up a lot with you know, in budgets, and we've kept things down, and then we just don't stay up with our maintenance, and then we're just going falling behind. So I think people have to realize that the federal storm water requirements, nothing we can do about that, right?
Mm-hmm.
If they come down and tell us we're going to do it, we're going to do it. So, I mean, budgeting for it, I think, is really important and intelligent. Do you think, nobody can predict, but the winter, have you budgeted sufficiently if we got smacked?
There is sufficient budget remaining in the, let's say if we got 30 inches of snow, I hope not, in November, December, yeah, we're covered. 20 inches of snow, we're definitely covered. Because we go and go till December 31st on the fiscal budget. So, yes, we're adequately covered. And we had positions, a vehicle maintenance position and other positions that didn't get filled this year, not till later in the year. So as a grand total for the budget, we're well under target. And I think there's sufficient room to handle whatever happens.
Good. The telephone thing you talked about, now that's going to, in effect, though, increase the productivity and increase the efficiency of your department. So it's something that's going up, but it's something that's going to pay for itself, hopefully, in the end, and make it much safer. It would be the fact, wouldn't it?
Right.
Yeah. So I mean, that's all very good. Overtime is stuff we really don't have a lot of control over, because of the fact that it's contractual, or we have to. Well, I mean, because of the services we're providing.
It's indirectly, it's a choice. If we elect. A couple times we've talked about what's the possibility of adding staff to the department. If we, and in the past for budgetary reasons, we've avoided that. Well, when we avoid that, we choose another path, and the other path is additional overtime. We're already paying the health benefits and the retirement benefits. There's a less of an increase just to pay the overtime than it is to add, let's say, 5, 10, 15 people. So I think that's it's a choice, and that's where you, as a result of that choice, that's where we see that fall out in that line. Would you?
I would agree. And some of the services that we provide on the weekends, in order to have coverage, you have to have overtime because the contracts don't allow for hiring full-time people to work on weekends outside of their contractual work hours and days. So right. It's the services that we provide that drive the overtime costs.
Right. And if we were to provide, if we were to hire more people, the benefits would then
right. Then you'd see the town's budget increase in other
right.
areas.
Right.
Like. With an understanding that the hiring of more people, I mean, you made a great comment, the level of service we currently give. But as the demand on our services increase, that level of service to keep giving it, you know, at some point mm-hmm. lends itself to, well, there's not enough overtime. You know, right. there's people. So it is a balance right now.
Yeah, last works. Winter, like in snow removal, everybody was willing to work the overtime. The winter before, they were just saying enough is enough, especially when we got into the 100-inch mark. So, yeah, there is a point of no return.
No, I think I think you've done a good job, and people have to realize too that your department services every single solitary person in town,
mm-hmm.
and every single solitary person that comes into town.
Right.
Which is, I think, very important for people to realize. You know, it's a total service, and I agree with what Selectman Bean said that we should look at people that are using our, you know, outside the Rye and the state, see if we can't redo some contracts. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Appreciate what you do. Christy has some things I think in your budget. Christy, you want to say something?
I'm going to give you a brief review when they're done.
All right.
I just want my turn back for a few seconds. A few minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sure we'll see you again.
Oh, no, I'm not going in.
First, I did run upstairs, Rick, and parking lots last year on December 31st had taken in for the summer lease lot, or the rental lot, daily rentals, $585,377. This year, my September financials reported that we were at $557,802, so we're under by $27,000. But there were a few more concerts, so we could come out close to... being level, but we weren't over like I had stated, so I did find that out for you.
Thank you.
Yep, and I just wanted to do a little quick summary. We got the health insurance rates. You guys should have received those. I think it was last Wednesday. Overall, the health plans, they went up 6.7%, so I have adjusted the health insurance line item in our municipal part of the budget, so that'll end up being an increase from what I had projected. I had done a 5% increase, so we're going to be looking for another $52,531 there, and it's $61,895 more than what was budgeted for 2015. So I know we're not going to talk about municipal insurance yet because we still are waiting for workers' comp and stuff, but I kind of wanted to give you guys an update on where we were at with that. I provided each of you a little summary sheet. I know next week is supposed to be the final review, so I kind of gave you guys a breakdown of all of the departments that you guys have already met with and approved, and some of the departments that you were still wishing to take actions on, so you have that there. With the increase that we received for health insurance, the library budget that you guys did vote on last week, I should have held off on that. I always forget that they have their own health insurance line. So they're going to need another $397 for that budget. I don't know if you guys want to take action on that tonight so we can wrap up that one again. And then I also had for you in the finance department when I was here last week, I had mentioned that I am going to have an employee out on FMLA next year. So I have provided you with a breakdown of additional wages that I would like you to consider adding to the finance budget. It's a total of $12,365 for that. So that's something that you guys can review and we can visit next week. And then the gasoline and diesel, I know Director Jacobs brought that up a couple of times. I'm looking at the end of September numbers. So now we have actual gallons that we've purchased through the end of September. And this is across the entire budget for all the departments, not just Public Works. But by the end of this week, I will provide you, there are some lines there that I think are going to need to be increased. And then there'll be lines that need to be decreased. Because basically two years back, we were asked to really analyze those accounts. And so Fred and I and Jamie, we all work together. We are on the WEX card now, which has brought down the price of gasoline considerably from what we were paying at the state level. So we have we've set our unleaded fuel in the budget across the board at $1.95. And diesel at $2.35. And then on top of that, we've been tracking on a monthly basis the actual usage for each department, each vehicle, by line item. So we have, I think, a really good handle on what we're actually need to budget for gasoline and diesel. So I will get those numbers to you. And we also had provided you guys this week with the information on the street lights. You guys had asked for further information on upgrading to the LEDs and stuff. So you did receive all of that earlier today, I believe, from Fred. So that's another item that we will need to look at next week when you guys meet on the 31st. So I just kind of typed up a little summary for you guys there and figured I'd run through it just to give a quick briefing on where we need to go with that. And then lastly, we're going to switch gears from the budget and go to the tax rate. And when Ed was sitting here, he didn't have the complete breakdown. I did run upstairs and grab that also. So the tax rate was 16.08 for the municipal portion, but that is broken down into the municipal, the county, the local education, and the state education. So I think when I had sat before you, before the tax rate was set, I had said 6.42. It ended up coming up at 6.41 for the town portion. The county is 98 cents. The local education is $6.53, and the state education is $2.16. And then the precinct, like he had told you, Rick, is the 74 cents, just like Ed had said. So that has to be added for the precinct. So I think it was 16.82, I think is what he said. So that is the total tax breakdown. When I was here last week, we were talking about the average value of a single-family home, and I just wanted to correct myself in that. When I had used the $377,800, that is for the single-family without waterfront. Last year, when we did the same comparison for you, the rate that we used, I think, was $330,000, but that included everybody with the waterfront also. So I just wanted to point out the average single family home without waterfront is $377,800. The single family with waterfront is $404,200. And then Ed took it one step further this year to include the single family without land. The average is $394,900. So I just wanted to clear that up because there was some confusion. Ed received a few phone calls last week after that. So I wanted to clear that up also.
So when you say that, you mean it's a piece of larger than a 50 by 100 foot lot?
Yes. I believe that is the case, yes. So, and I think that is all that I had for you guys.
Before you leave, do we want to take a vote on the library?
I can give you the actual library budget number now. It does go up by $397, so it would be $856,588, and that's strictly related to the
insurance.
Yeah, like I said, I forgot that
Make that motion.
I'll second it.
Great.
Okay, all in favor? Unanimous.
Now, one thing I wanted to ask before you do leave is, and I know this isn't exact, but so what was the tax rate last year again? 19?
16.
The tap?
Of course, I left that folder upstairs. It was last year, it was, I think it's on the sheet here for us.
Yeah.
Yeah, I only have the municipal piece down here. Oh, it was, I think I have it on here. We have 791 for the municipal. I think it was 1916.
Yeah, and it's down to 1608. And 1608. And what, do you have any idea of what's going to happen at with the school?
The school is included in the 16.
So it is, okay.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to clear up, because when Ed was down here, he was making it sound a little bit like the municipal piece. The town portion was 1608. No. And I just wanted to clarify that the tax rate is 1608, and then it's broken down, the 641 for the town portion, and then the 98 cents for county local, is $6.53, so it's a little higher than the municipal rec to answer that part of the question. The state education is $2.16, and then the precinct was 74 cents. So that's how it's broken.
How, what about the county?
The county is 98 cents.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Yep. Thank you for your explanation.
Confusing.
Yes. We'll have the town manager's report, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the Department of Public Works will begin the collection of leaves on October 31st, and their program will end on December 4th. And I know that they've been out working all over the weekend to clean up leaves that are plugging drains and causing flooding. So that's an important function, to get rid of those little pesky devils before they cause any more trouble. Sidewalk repairs on High Street have been completed by the department. Street repairs are ongoing on Ann's Lane, and there is periodic lane closures involved. So please keep a sharp eye on what's going on there. Zoning amendments petitions may be submitted starting November 14th until December 14th. Regular petition articles other than zoning may be submitted at any time up until January 10th, 2017. The town continues to work with our engineers on the development of plans for the replacement of the Church Street sewer force main, and should be ready for presentation at the coming town meeting. By memo, I've requested the selectmen to review the street lighting agreements with the state on Route 1A. And that's it, sir.
Okay. Questions, Rick?
Now, could you just give us a little bit more information of the last thing that you just said about the street lights?
The town has a number of agreements that it has signed back in the last millennium dealing with street lights with the state.
They were taking some away.
Well, no, actually, there have been some eliminated since then because of various functions that have taken place. But we have a contractual obligation with the state on the 1981 reconstruction of Route 1A for a number of lighting fixtures and facilities that were located, as well as the underground conduit to feed them and the cables. That was a 10-year agreement that expired in 1991, and then it automatically renews every March of each year for an additional year. So we've tasked that to the board and giving you the information. There are also a number of other agreements that were signed with the state, and I gave you a list of all the lights that they include, and it's virtually everything on Route 1, or 1A, excuse me. They are 10-year increments on the contracts, and when they expire, they're automatically renewed for an additional 10 years. I gave you all that material because we're about to start the process with the state of working on the reconstruction of Route 1A, and certainly that should come into play. Discussions on those items when that occurs, so you'll know what's what specifically as far as the agreements are concerned and what should be done with them or how they should be changed.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Welch, thank you, great report. And just going a little bit more global and expanding on our request for the director with municipal platforms that contract with the town in a review of that. The lighting raises another issue. And if there are other, and I don't need an answer, we don't need an answer. But anybody that is a municipal platform that has contracts with the town, if we could get a synopsis of that for the board's review and to make sure that these are equitable, both to the people that are sharing our services and our infrastructure, and certainly to the Hampton taxpayer. I think it's prudent that we review those, look at those. That would include lighting. Not only is it just lighting with the state of New Hampshire, if there are other entities that have lighting contracts, sewer contracts, any firm, to include the state using our recycling or refuse plant. If we could get a list of those as time permits, and if the board has no objection, if we could get that on as a document, that would be great. And thank you for your diligent work and discovering that and going to work on that with your department heads.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Regina?
Thank you. I have nothing, Mr. Chairman.
When you say, just for the public, explain, when you say regularly petitioned articles other than zoning may be submitted, what is a regular petitioned article?
Anything that a citizen can think up, wants to have the town do, but that's legal, of course. And they need to do a petition article. They need 25 signatures of 25 registered voters. And I always try to caution folks, because when we get those articles in here, a number of them are not certified as being legally registered voters. So we suggest people, instead of getting 25, get 35 or 40 signatures. Always ask people if they are registered voters. There is a format for that's in fact in the town report. You can submit any of those things that deal with appropriations or special projects they wish the town to undertake, studies, anything. And as long as the town meeting passes it, that will be accomplished in the following year. But it needs to go on the warrant. The nice thing about a petition article, I guess from the standpoint of folks who wish to submit them, is nobody can change them. Only the deliberative session of town meeting can change that petition warrant article.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Anything else for the town manager? All right, old business?
I just wanted to ask another question. That's not that I'm definitely beating the bushes for trees or whatever, but remember the tree that we planted that we received from UNH? And it was down, I believe, at the Ruth Simpson Park.
I believe it was. I believe Recreation planted that, yes.
Is it still there?
As far as I know, yes.
So it's growing. You don't know.
It's a difficult environment for a tree down there, simply because of the salt air and salt water.
Yeah, because I heard there was a tree down there in that area that people were regularly pulling the branches off so it wouldn't grow.
No.
And that somebody has already moved that particular tree, so it's not the same tree.
Yeah, I don't believe that's the same tree. But I'll check on it to make sure that it is not.
Yeah, because, you know, at some point, I know that at the Hampton Area Commission, they are talking about putting more trees, for instance, on Ashworth Avenue. I mean,
yes.
Who knows if that's going to happen and the state would be doing it or whatever. But I think that, you know, in the event that we do these things, you know, just because people possibly don't want trees there because they want to have a better view or whatever, I think that we're going to need to look at how we would reinforce that if people would just start killing trees that might be planted.
Oh. Well, I live down there, and I don't see any evidence of that.
Yeah, I hear it's opposite your condo.
Well, I see no evidence of that taking place, and any trees that be planted down at the ocean should be native to the ocean environment and not not something that's not you know, native to that.
Well, there were a lot of trees that were down were native and they're not here now, and they're not just Rosa rugosas.
If a person does damage a municipally owned tree, there are severe penalties in the law for that.
Yeah. At one time, there were a ton of willow trees at the beach. Those are all gone now for one reason or another.
Now, willow trees tend to be a problem. But
yeah, especially if your car is parked under them.
Absolutely.
But, I mean, there were a lot of trees like that.
Yes, there were. Yep, I agree. And it's a great environment for them because of all the water.
Yeah, they suck up the water.
Oh, they certainly do.
And they were in the same area that now they have lots of flooding.
Yes, yes, that's true. And they did prohibit some of that.
Okay, new business. We have acceptance of salt marsh parcels, map 998, lots 319 and 320.
I'll defer to town council on that, Mr. Chairman, who was here,
okay,
and who drew all the deeds and did all the nice things that are required to get this before you. Good evening.
Evening.
This is a donation that is being made of 7.5 acres of salt marsh. There are two different parcels. One is 3.5 acres in Hampton, and the other is 4 acres, which is partly in Hampton and partly in Hampton Falls. It is something that has been proposed to be given to the Conservation Commission. The commission has already voted pursuant to its statute to accept the gift, subject to your approval. This is consistent with the policy the board has been pursuing of obtaining ownership of these salt marsh parcels. And the fact that there is part in Hampton Falls does not pose a problem. By statute, that would not be taxable once it is under municipal ownership, even if it's not the same municipality.
Right. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Unanimous?
Thank you.
And review and approve contract for discounted electrical services.
Mr. Chairman, our current contract expires next month, November. We have been diligently working with the individual who is our representative and has been working very closely with us for the last 3 years. We have a current contract which over that 3-year period has saved the taxpayers $77,000 in electrical fees. And we'd like to continue to save that kind of money. Certainly we worked very hard to get that done, and I know our consultant has worked very hard to get that done. The prices that we have received are even less than they were 3 years ago. But in order to continue this program, we need the board's approval to do that. And over the next 2 years, our cost per kilowatt hour has gone down almost half a cent per kilowatt hour used. And we use a lot of kilowatt hours. This saves us a significant amount of money, particularly at the wastewater treatment plant. This is a open-scaled contract, and we can freeze that when we reach a low point at some point in time during the 2 years, and it will not raise the cost of current during that entire period. But we are starting at a half a cent less than we are paying now for current energy. And in order to do this, we need the board's approval to move forward in the coming 2 years using the same vendor that we have had before.
Okay.
Could you frame that motion, please, Mr. Welch?
It would move that we engage Titan Energy on a 24-month variable rate float with ISO New England wholesale market for the purchase of electricity, and that the manager be permitted on behalf of the town to sign the contract.
So moved.
Second it.
Any discussion? Is this something that has to go out to bid, or is this?
We've already gone to 3 different vendors, okay, and this is the low vendor.
All right.
We've been doing this now for 3 years, and it's worked out very well. These folks have been very good to us and have kept us updated every single month of that 3-year period. So this would be the recommended company we go with. The others were higher.
Okay. All in favor? Unanimous.
That's it, sir.
Closing comments.
Mr. Chairman, if you would, I would appreciate the board entertaining a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91-A:3(2), small c and small e.
As you were, Counselor, I had some closing comments, Mr. Waddell.
Okay.
Thank you. Stand by, please. Mr. Chairman, I would just like to thank you for your esteemed leadership tonight. Perhaps it's a harbinger of things to come, but you look good in the chair.
thank you.
We really appreciate you stepping in tonight. Nice job.
All right. And I have one thing also. I wasn't suggesting that anyone from your condo did that. I just was saying
oh, no, I know you weren't.
In that area. Yeah.
All right.
And then one other is Mr. Welch, outstanding Sir. Work on that. That is all of your work, but on that energy contract. And $70,000 is huge cake, and it's diligence on your part and your subordinates. And thank you for your leadership on that.
Thank you. We'd like to double it the next period.
Thank you, sir. That's all, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. So, a motion to adjourn?
No, you first need that motion for a non-public session under RSA 91.
I'll make that motion.
Yeah.
Okay, Rick's made the motion.
I'll second it.
And you need a roll call?
Yes, please.
Sir. Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Like four ayes.
All right, so we're now in non-public. Yes?